HarperCollins and Harper Audio present What's Gotten Into You? The Story of Your Body's Atoms, From the Big Bang Through Last Night's Dinner, by Dan Levitt. Read by Mike Chamberlain. A note before we begin. For notes on the text, additional reading materials, and the author's acknowledgments, don't forget to download the accompanying enhancement PDF from your audiobook provider, or go directly to harpercollins.com/pages/what's gotten into you. We are an example of what hydrogen atoms can do, given 15 billion years of cosmic evolution. Carl Sagan. Introduction. $1,942.29 in the bank. This book was inspired by a warning. When my teenage daughter decided to become a vegetarian, I recalled a caution I had received from my grandfather, who once owned a small hunting lodge, and, at 90, still loved wild game. He told me it was unhealthy not to eat meat. I also recalled that Henry David Thoreau once received a similar admonition from a farmer. You cannot live on vegetable food solely, for it furnishes nothing to make bones with. As the farmer spoke, Thoreau noted wryly, he stood behind sturdy oxen who pulled him and his lumbering plow along in spite of every obstacle with vegetable-made bones. So when my daughter told me of her intentions, I was sympathetic. I knew her bones were not in grave danger if she became a vegetarian. But I began to wonder, what exactly are we made of? I'd studied science in college and spent years making science films. I thought I knew a fair amount. Yet I realized that I knew less about what I was composed of than I knew about what lay inside my computer or my car. So I began asking questions. What is inside us? That seems easy. Muscle, organs, and bones. What are these made of? Cells, molecules, and atoms. Go on. What are they made of? That's a lot harder. Where did they come from? I'm not sure. And how do we know any of this? Not a clue. My questions sparked a flurry of Googling, reading, and conversations with remarkably patient scientists. I soon found myself hooked by an epic tale. I discovered that our atoms have seen so much that, if they could speak, they'd probably never stop talking. Their history begins at the beginning of time, and their dramatic odyssey across billions of years was only revealed, I discovered, by many surprising, even shocking discoveries. As time went on, my investigation evolved into something deeper. Themes and connections emerged, and I discovered that taking the long view also revealed the majesty of our existence in a way I'd never before appreciated. Carl Sagan once famously said, "We are made of star stuff." This is the improbable story of how it happened. The story begins with the truly bizarre discovery that all matter, everything around and within us, has an ultimate birthday. The day the universe was born. We'll see how, on our atoms' long strange journeys toward us, they were transformed into stars, helped assemble our planet, and then hunkered down while the newborn Earth endured unimaginable catastrophes. Once things calmed down, those dead atoms, in stunning recombinations, brought forth life, terraformed Earth, and created plants, which at last made our own existence possible. Finally, we'll see how our bodies transform the food on our dinner plates into us. Mind you, our own interiors are so vast that it's difficult to fathom how bewilderingly complex we truly are. You are an ever-changing mosaic, a colony of 30 trillion cells, each made of over 100 trillion atoms that are dancing in riotous, vibrating shuffles. You contain a billion times more atoms than all the grains of sand in the Earth's deserts. If you weigh 150 pounds, you carry around enough carbon to make 25 pounds of charcoal, enough salt to fill a salt shaker, enough chlorine to disinfect several backyard swimming pools, and enough iron to make a 3-inch nail. If you sorted all your elements, you'd find that about 60 on the periodic table are represented inside you. If you could sell them, you'd pocket a cool $1,942.29. Exact estimates vary by weight and market price. In pursuing this strange tale, I came to understand that the mere fact that we can reconstruct the history of our atoms across billions of years is as deeply surprising as if we were able to piece together the history of a typhoon from the shadows of a few raindrops. But the clues were all around us. They had simply lain long hidden. They were to be found in the fleeting traces of invisible particles that rained down from space, in the fact that each element emits a unique set of wavelengths of light, in the unexpected timetables of comets' returns to Earth, in the discovery that life flourishes in the bone-crushing depths of the dark ocean floor. The stories of the scientists in these pages are as compelling as the discoveries they unearthed. Behind their unexpected findings were investigations marked by fierce rivalries, obsession, heartbreak, flashes of insight, and flukes of blind luck. Again and again, clues were overlooked until someone was willing to entertain ideas that everyone else knew were wrong. I had no idea when I began that I would also learn about the unconscious workings of our brains that cloud our thinking. We all succumb to unconscious assumptions, called cognitive biases or thinking traps, that influence how we see the world. The negative bias, for instance, leads us to pay more attention to unpleasant events and helps explain why our media focuses on bad news. In these pages, we will see that a small number of particular thinking traps repeatedly prevented whole communities of scientists from recognizing great breakthroughs, even when confronted by overwhelming evidence. We'll encounter 6 biases so frequently that I've given them nicknames. The too weird to be true bias. The if our current tools haven't detected it, it doesn't exist bias. The as an expert, I've lost sight of how much is still unknown bias. The you look for and see the evidence that matches your existing theory bias. The world's greatest expert must be correct bias. The because it seems most likely, it must be true bias. In a world rife with biases, the scientists who made great breakthroughs were tremendously brave to go against the grain. Some are well known, most are not. Like 2 women, one a Jewish physicist, the other, well, a Nazi, who collaborated to search for subatomic particles, the Austrian Empress's personal physician who discovered photosynthesis, the hard-of-hearing chemist who discovered DNA over 80 years before Watson and Crick found its structure, or the renegade biochemist, ridiculed as a fraud and prophet of doom, who revolutionized our understanding of ourselves. It seems progress in science often leaps out of dark corners and unexpected places. Let's begin this strange history of your body and mine, then, with a man who always wore black. Part 1. The Journey Begins. From a Big Bang to a Rocky Home. In which we make the shocking discovery that all the particles within us were born in a single instant, discover their surprising nature, puzzle out the outlandish ways in which they became our elements, and learn how, improbably, a monstrous cloud of dust with our atoms scattered within it created a planet hospitable to life. 1. Happy birthday to everyone. The priest who discovered the beginning of time. All great truths begin as blasphemies. George Bernard Shaw. On a cold, uncharacteristically dry London day in September 1931, a short, stocky man with slicked back hair, a piercing gaze, and a hell of a lot of nerve walked along Story's Gate Street. He entered Central Hall, Westminster, a large assembly place near Westminster Abbey. It's hard to imagine that this man, a 37-year-old Belgian professor of physics, did not feel some trepidation. The soaring dome of the Great Hall imposed grandeur on the proceedings, a celebration of the 100th anniversary of the British Association for the Advancement of Science. Many of the world's most eminent physicists were among the audience of 2000, to whom Georges Lemaître was about to present a theory that bordered on the crackpot. Lemaître was not just a physicist and a mathematician, but a Catholic priest as well, and he was to speak in a session on a topic that physicists had just begun to grapple with, the evolution of the universe. Dressed in his black clerical garb and white collar, as if prepared to take confessions, he stepped to the podium and presented an idea that veered perilously close to theology. He had discovered, he claimed, a moment when the entire universe exploded out of a tiny primeval atom. Many other speakers presented ideas that were also electrifying, to say the least. The famed astronomer James Jeans suggested that the universe's days were numbered. The mathematician Ernest Barnes, himself an Anglican bishop, speculated that the universe was so vast, it must contain many inhabited worlds, and there must exist beings on some of them who are immeasurably beyond our mental level. But Lemaître's theory was the strangest of all. He claimed that physics could address almost the very instant of creation. Few of the great and good in the hall took his remarks seriously. Those who were not simply mystified were deeply skeptical. Virtually all the physicists and astronomers in the audience believed that the universe had always existed. Lemaître's claim that it had not seemed preposterous. Although they failed to realize it at the time, his insight would lead to one of the greatest achievements in all of science, the mind-blowing discovery that there was a single moment when the most elementary particles within all visible matter, including you and me, sprang into existence. Lemaître's search for truth began years earlier, in the blood-soaked trenches of the First World War. He had been a student at the Catholic University of Leuven, intending to take up the sensible career of a coal mine engineer, when, on the morning of August 4, 1914, German troops poured across the Belgian border, plunging Europe into war. Instead of taking a planned cycling trip, both Lemaître and his brother promptly enlisted and hiked 4 days to join a volunteer unit at the front. Within 2 weeks, they were fighting with outdated single-loading rifles. As an infantryman, Lemaître had the misfortune to witness the first successful poison gas attack in war. The Kaiser's army, acting on the brainstorm of the chemist Fritz Haber, whom we'll meet again, released chlorine gas along the front. It dissolved the lungs of unsuspecting Allied soldiers, sending them shrieking from the battlefield. The madness of it would never fade from his memory, Lemaître's colleague recalled. Later, in the artillery, he was mired in ghastly exchanges of explosive shells. Family legend says his scientific bent kept him from getting a promotion because he couldn't keep from correcting the ballistic calculations of his superior. He lacked, it seemed, the attitude expected of an officer. However, Lemaître had brought physics books with him, and in the intervals of trench warfare, while waiting for shells to fly, he somehow found the concentration to read the work of the French physicist Henri Poincaré and ponder the ultimate nature of reality. In the squalor of wood and dirt trenches, Lemaître mused about a big question. What was the universe ultimately made of? For the young man, who came from a deeply religious family, physics and prayer both brought solace. Lemaître emerged from the war a decorated veteran, his brother an officer. But the war had seared Lemaître's soul. When peace arrived after 4 years, a practical career in engineering no longer seemed so important. Instead, he was torn between his two loves, religion and science. Returning to university in Belgium, he sped through a master's degree in mathematics and physics. These were exciting times. At the University of Berlin, A brash physicist named Albert Einstein had just confounded his colleagues with a radical, profoundly unsettling theory that the mass of an object actually warps the space and time around it. Lemaître was captivated. Yet, when he graduated, he abruptly changed direction. He enrolled in a seminary. There were two ways of arriving at the truth, he would say later. I decided to follow them both. Once ordained, Lemaître took a vow of poverty. He joined a small priestly association, Les Amis de Jésus, which emphasized the continued development of piety. Then he promptly returned to physics. Some of his more progressive professors at university, following the teaching of St. Thomas Aquinas, taught that the Bible could not be a literal.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.